QuickBooks Pro Plus Desktop 2022, entering transactions for the purchase of investments using bank feeds. Get ready because we bookkeeping pros are moving up the hilltop with QuickBooks Pro Plus Desktop 2022. Here we are in our bank feed practice file, going through the setup process with the view dropdown, the open windows list on the left-hand side, the company dropdown, the home page in the middle, maximizing it to the gray area. Reports drop down, company and financial go on down to the balance sheet standard. We're then going to customize the report up top, changing the range from 010121 to 123121, fonts and numbers, bringing that font up to 14. Okay, yes, please, and okay. Then we will go to the reports drop down again, company and financial. Look at that profit and loss standard. We're going to change the date range from 010121 to 123121. Then customize the report up top, fonts and numbers, changing the font size up to 14 again. Okay, yes, please, and okay. Then we'll do this one more time with the reports drop down, accounting and taxes, going to the trial balance with a range change from 010121 to 123121, customizing this report, and then going to the fonts and numbers, changing the font up to 14. Okay, yes, please, and okay. Then we're going to go into our bank feed center by going to the banking drop down and going into the bank feeds and the bank feed center, which would only be there if you had turned on the bank feeds, which we have done, and maximizing it to the gray area. And then I'm going to go over to the unrecognized items here. We're going to be looking for transactions where there's a bank feed going out of the checking account that we're imagining that we're putting into some type of investments, such as stocks and bonds. Let's go back to the balance sheet and think about what would happen with regards to this, noting that if we're taking money out of the checking account and putting them into stocks and bonds, this is something that might happen on the business side, but if your business is not in the business of investing in stocks and bonds, it might not be as, you might not have as many transactions there for that particular purpose, unless you're kind of holding on to the stocks and bonds that you're later going to use for investment in the business. For example, if this business was in the business of selling guitars, then if we had excess cash that we plan on using in the business to expand later, we might put that into investments like stocks and bonds. But if we have cash that has accumulated and we don't expect to be using it at some point in the future, then it would be best to give it to the owner in the form of draws or dividends so that the owner can take that cash and make a return on it investing as well. If you're in on the personal side of things and you're using QuickBooks for personal bookkeeping, which is quite common as well, you have similar kind of issues. In that case, you would most likely have money that you're investing in investment accounts, and you'd have to think about, well, how exactly am I going to track that information? Can the bank feeds help with that? So the transaction we're looking at now is taking money out of the checking account, putting it into some type of investment account. And it could be like mutual funds or something like that, with an investment company, possibly like an E-Trade or Vanguard or something like that. And so clearly the transaction is going to be a decrease in the checking account, which is when we will see it hitting the bank feed transactions and when we can record it. And then we want to put the other side not into an expense account, which would typically be what we would do for many decreases to the checking account, but instead to an asset account, similar like what we did with the inventory and equipment, but this time an other current asset account, possibly simply called an investment type of account. So there's a couple kind of issues you have with this kind of process. One would be, what about the beginning balance on my investment account for the transactions I had before I started entering the data? In other words, the stuff that's going to be clearing the bank at this point in time are the current transactions, but I already have money in the account. In that case, you would have to do a transaction that's not journal, that is not cash related, because it happened at some point in the past, just doing a journal entry or possibly just going into the register and entering that beginning balance. So that's one kind of issue. The second issue is, how am I going to set up my investment accounts? Do I just want one account called investments for all of my investments, all my different mutual funds and bonds, or do I want multiple different accounts? And for that, Normally, you don't want to get too overboard with multiple different accounts and the detail that you're going to be putting into QuickBooks, because that'll make it a lot more difficult for you to enter the data into QuickBooks. It's not really designed for day-to-day kind of transactions. It's designed to give you a summary periodically, most likely monthly or on a yearly basis. So one method you might use is to say, I'm going to basically put stuff into one investment account and then possibly make sub-accounts related to either account types of investment, or possibly more easily by the type of entity that I'm investing in, or the financial institution like a Vanguard or like an E-Trade or like your bank or something like that, and list it out by the institution, because that's going to be the statements that you will have, and then tie into those statements periodically and then have the detail with the statements. You also might break out the short-term and long-term investments, which is another kind of issue. In other words, especially on the personal side, you might have retirement accounts that are in a 401k or an IRA. Those are items you might want to break out as long-term, because you can't touch them as easily. You can't take them out so that until you're retired. So that in those investments, you might want to have a short-term and a long-term broken out between whether something is under the umbrella of a 401k or an IRA or something like that, or whether it is not. And you can, and those are some ways that you can break it out. The next thing we got to think about is, well, what about the income that I'm going to have in terms of gains? And what about the dividends and so on? When we talk about the income with regards to dividends and interest, that stuff will flow through typically to, it might flow through to your checking account if you're to receive the gains. I'm not the gains, but the dividends and the interest. At that point, you can then record it just like you would on a cash basis. Or you might have a system where you're reinvesting the dividends and interest, in which case they're going to be reinvestments into the actual stock price, and you'll see the value of the stock going up as you have the reinvestments. You also could have short-term gains or unrealized gains. And then there's the question of, how am I going to recognize the unrealized gains? And do I want to recognize the unrealized gains? So we'll talk a little bit about that as well, because there's a question of, do you want to put the gains on the balance sheet or, in essence, on the income statement? Where do you want to put them? On the income statement. Okay, so now let's go to the lists dropdown. I'm going to go to the list dropdown. We're going to go to the chart of accounts. We're going to set up our investment account. I'm going to set this up as if we have one investment account, a parent account, and then I'm going to put by institution the accounts underneath it by the institutions, financial institutions I'm investing in. So I'm going to say the account rise up down below, new account. I'm going to make this the parent account, which I'm just going to call other current assets. And I'm just going to call this in short-term investments, or just say investments. And then this will be the parent account. So I'm just going to say save it. And then I'm going to make another one, which is going to be the account rise up, new account. And then this one I'm going to say is going to be an other current asset as well. And this one is going to be the financial institution that I'm investing in. Primerica. And that'll make it easier, because I'm going to get the statements from them, which I'll then take a look at monthly or when transactions happen that clear my actual bank account. And I'm going to make this a subsidiary account of the investments account. So now we've got kind of this breakout. We got the investments and then the sub account. I'll make one more just to give it an idea of how this would work. Account rise up, new account. I'm going to make this one like the financial institution, other assets. And let's just call this, pretend it was our bank, like Bank of America. And then I'm going to make that a sub account of, once again, the investment account. It's an other current asset, not an other asset, other current asset, sub account of the investments account, and then save it and close it. So now you can see how this works out. I'm going to have the investments and then these sub accounts that will be put in place underneath them. Let's pretend that I have a beginning balance in the Primerica account from my statement. If I go into that register by double clicking on it, I'm going to close the caret. I'm going to put this in place as of typically, let's say, the beginning of the year. So 01/01 2-1, and I'm going to say that we have an increase. Let's just pretend there was, 10,000 in it at the beginning. It's a non-cash transaction. Therefore, the other side has to go somewhere, and it would have to go to some kind of equity account. So it would be going into some kind of equity down here, which I'm going to say is owner's equity. So, and this is to record initial investment. Initial TIAL investment or original investment. And so it's going to retained earnings and it's 90 days old. Okay, I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that. And then if I close this, I'm going to close this out and open up the caret. So now we've got under the investments here, we've got this caret that allows you to expand it. And then we have that original 10,000, which is a non-cash type of transaction. Now, if we were to put more money into it from this point forward, we would see those happening in the bank feeds. So if I go over to the bank feeds, for example, and say, let's close up the caret, and I'm going to open up this one, and I'm just going to look for these types of items. Here's one. I'm just going to pretend that this is an investment account, even though it's life insurance here, but we're going to pretend that's going to be an investment. So we'll put that in there and we're going to say okay. And the payee once again is going to be Primerica. So I'm going to say Primerica tab. And the account now is going to be the investment account. Investment instead of an expense account. We don't have a job. There is that. And so we're going to then say okay. And if I hit the drop down and add more details to it, the date matches out. That was given to us. Here we got the payee, the investment, the customer job, the memo. We could make it billable, but we're not going to. We could create a rule for this, but we're not going to here because we're just going to do a practice thing here. We'll get into the rules later. So I'm going to just save that, save it to the register. And so it's been added to the register as we can see here. Let's go back to the caret on the left-hand side. And then go back to our balance sheet where we can see now it's been added here. So we've got the inclusion here, double clicking on it. Now we're at that 10,000, 25, 50 or whatever the Primerica. If I double click on that is the check. If I double click on it takes us to a check type of form, closing this back out, closing this back out. The other side, of course, is in the checking account. So we've got all this activity happening in the checking account. So that's how we can, of course, I'm going to close this back out, account for the us putting more money into this account. So that's one kind of issue that is taken care of. The other issue is going to be, well, how do I account for the income? If I have dividends and I have interest, if I have that dividend and interest that's going to be flowing into my checking account, we will see them in the bank feeds as well. And we can simply record them to interest income and dividend income as they come through. But what about the unrealized gains? Meaning you might want to check periodically to your statements and try to increase your accounts or decrease your accounts, whatever the market is doing, to the market value periodically. The problem with that is that you haven't yet sold your investments. Therefore, that increase and decrease is temporary. We don't know if it's going to be a long-term thing or not. That's just the current value. We call that having not realized it yet. So if we're going to say, okay, I want to record my investments at the market value to then adjust them to what they say on the statements, then the question is, well, I can then increase this, but where does the other side go? Where am I going to put the other side? And there's a couple responses to that traditionally. I won't get into it in detail, but one, you can record it as income, even though it's unrealized income on the income statement, which could be kind of a distortion because, again, it's unrealized. So you could have major increases and decreases in the market that you haven't locked in, so you haven't realized them. Or two, you could put a contra account on the equity section down here that would then be in recording the increase and decrease down here, and that way it wouldn't hit the income statement and distort the income statement. Most of the time, the easiest thing to do is actually record it on the income statement, but put it at the bottom in other income so you have a subcategory of your normal income and then the other incomes that are basically like investment income. You could also, if you choose, make a sub-account here that's representing the changes that are the unrealized gains and losses. So let me just show you what that would look like. And this would be an adjustment that's not cash related. It would be an adjustment that you would do periodically at the end of the period based on your statements that you get from your financial institution, possibly monthly. And then you want to just record some summary of the data. You don't want to put too much detail into QuickBooks. If you're looking at the day-to-day changes, you want to look at that with the actual reports that you're getting from the from your company, your investment institution, and possibly other software that can help you with the day-to-day transaction. QuickBooks is here to give you a good snapshot on a period-by-period basis. So let's go ahead and add a sub-account of this. I'm going to go into the, and let's imagine that this account now has gone up to 10,525. So I want to record that increase of $500. If I go to my lists dropdown, my chart of accounts, one way I could do it is I could go directly here and increase this one by the $5,000, the other side having to go to something like undeposited funds. Or I might want to create another account and say, let's make a new one. And let's say that we're going to say that this is going to be an other current asset account. And I'm going to call it unrealized gain slash loss for Primerica. So I'm going to save it. And then I'm going to make this a subcategory of the Primerica account, and then save it and close it. So now record my gain in here. So I'm going to double click on that unrealized gain and loss account. Let's make this as of 10/30/21, for example. This is going to be an increase of that $500 we're imagining. The other side needs to go somewhere. I'm going to make it go to an income account. So I'm going to call it unrealized gain slash loss space, because I want to make a new account, an income statement account. And then tab, it's going to set up a new account. We're going to put this as an income account, but not a normal income, an other income account, which we'll put it at the bottom of the income statement. And then save it and close it. I could put a memo, but I'm not going to here. I probably should. And then I'm going to close this out and close this out. And so now you've got the investments, you've got the Primerica, and then you've got the two components to it. The Primerica, this is the original investment, what you have put in to it, kind of like the cost. You could think of it kind of like the basis. And then we've got the unrealized gains and losses that have not been realized, that are just representing increases in the value over and above what we paid for. And then you get the total. That adds a little bit more detail, although it's also a little bit more complex to deal with. You could just put them into one account if you so choose, depending on how much detail you want. Now you can imagine this other side, the unrealized gains and losses. If you wanted to record them in the equity section, then you would have the equal and opposite account down here, representing the other side of it, so it wouldn't be on the income statement. But I think for most people, it's easiest to put on the income statement, which is what we did. If I go to the profit and loss on the income statement, we've got the unrealized gains down here. This is an income account, but it's not at the top. We put it down here in the other income so that we have our net income from ordinary operations. And then we can also see the other kind of unrealized stuff down below. So oftentimes this, you know, tracking of the investments can be a little bit tricky for people to understand or think about how they want to record the investments. What are they going to do with the unrealized gains and losses? How do you break out those from the normal gains and losses and investments as they happen? So it's in how do the bank feeds, of course, work into that. So that's the general idea, is that you could basically put this information onto the balance sheet when you're paying for the investments, which you might be doing periodically, because you might have a system that you're periodically putting money into a 401k plan or into your investments or something like that. And then you might want to adjust your investments periodically based on, this would be possibly monthly or quarterly, based on the current market value from the financial statements, and then record the increases and decreases, the unrealized gains and losses periodically at that point in time. And then the dividends and the interest would generally flow through, if you're receiving them in your checking account, to your checking account, and you could basically record the gains and losses. Otherwise, they would be part of the increase to the value that you'd be paying back into the stocks and bonds that you could see when you get the financial statements and record them at that point in time when you get the data, the financial reports from the financial institutions.